Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with singing and with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever. And his faithfulness continues to each generation. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's worship.
Thank you.
us this morning and give us that joy that we need to get through the day. In Jesus' name we pray.
Abraham had a son of the promise whose name was Isaac. Isaac had a son of the promise whose name was Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons and one daughter named Dinah, who for reasons no one really understands was just someone in the kitchen strumming on the old banjo, but that's another story. The next to the youngest was named Joseph. Joseph is an arrogant lad and is human trafficked by his brothers to some slave traders, sold as a slave down into Egypt. But the hand of God is with him. Even though he starts off as a slave, he rises to be second in command to the king of Egypt that we call the Pharaoh. He's there when a time of famine hits back up home, where Jacob and the brothers and Dinah are living. There's a famine. They come down to Egypt. He's able to give them food. They're there. In fact, the whole family moves down there. Now they're in Egypt. They live there, or their descendants live there, for 430 years. But during those 430 years, they really sink in the status there in Egypt, and they become the slaves. They are making the bricks for Pharaoh's monuments until God raises up a liberator, a man named Moses. Moses says, "Let my people go." Pharaoh says, "No, because they're useful to me. I will not let them go." And Moses takes these 10 plagues. Pharaoh finally wakes up in the middle of the night. His son's dead. And he says, "Get out of here. You've become a stench to us." So in one of the biggest jailbreaks in history, Moses takes about somewhere between 2 and 6 million people out of Egypt. Not all Hebrews, but different people. They all head toward the sea, down toward the Red Sea. They get there. Pharaoh changes his mind. He chases them. Charlton Heston stands up with his staff. The sea parts. He walks across on dry land. Everybody follows him. The sea comes back in. Pharaoh and his men are killed. Well, Pharaoh's not killed, but his men are killed. Now they're out in the desert. Moses leads them around for about 40 years, waiting to get back into the promised land that Abraham had had, along with Isaac and Jacob. Moses finally dies, taken over by Joshua. The leadership is taken over by Joshua. Joshua leads them across the Jordan River. The walls of Jericho fall down. They reconquer the land. They're led by women like Deborah, men like Gideon and Samson. Really kind of a lawless period. Finally, the people say, "We want a king. We want a king." God says, "Nah, I don't think you do." And they said, "Yeah, we want a king." He says, "Okay." He gives them a king named Saul, who starts out well, ends poorly. The next king is David. David's the best king they ever had. This is like the golden age for these people. David has a son named Solomon, who is reported to be the wisest man who ever lived, but I don't think so because he had 1,000 wives. I mean, just think of the birthdays. That's an average of 3 a day. Solomon's son is named Rehoboam, and then the unfortunately named Jeroboam. They split, there's this rebellion, and they split the kingdom in two. Now you've got kings in the north, and you've got kings in the south. Well, the kings of the north didn't want their folks going back down south all the time to the temple in Jerusalem, so they said, "Let's make up our own religion." And they figured out, if you're going to make up your own religion, you might as well make it easy. So who wants to be a priest? Okay, you. And your priest, little smear a little oil on their forehead. They set up their own days, their own holidays. But we need a God. What are we going to make for a God? I know. They remembered way back when Moses had been getting the Ten Commandments. They remembered that Aaron and some others had made a golden calf. Like, you know, a cow, a little cow, a golden calf. And they had said, "This is your God." So they made 2 golden calves. And now up in the northern part of Israel, what we call Israel, they've got these 2 golden calves, and they said, "This is your God." And everybody's like, "Yeah." One of the worst kings was named King Ahab. Now, don't confuse him with Captain Ahab, you know, of Moby Dick. This is King Ahab. the worship of this statue made out of gold. Not only is he making up his own religion, he marries a foreign princess named Jezebel. Jezebel is from a place called Sidon. So she and Ahab, now they're married, and they're looking around, and she's like, well, what do you got for a guy? He said, well, we got this calf. Seriously, you got a calf for a guy? Couldn't you have done something a little, you know, lion? Something a little bigger. She says, I'll tell you what, we'll bring in one of my gods. We'll import a god from where I live. So she brings it in, rolls it in. Here's a statue, and this is a god to Satan. This is Baal. Now, you know the word Beelzebub. That's another word for Satan. Well, this is the worship of the first part of that Beelzebub. So she brings out, okay, now this is a god, you know, that people can be afraid of. So they introduce the worship of Baal. Jezebel is like, she's the worst one on Housewives of the Jezreel Valley. She's a master of palace intrigue. She's a backstabber. She's a gossiper. She's a conniver. Mothers and fathers do not name their daughters Jezebel, even to this day. Because she was like the worst woman ever. Like, here's one thing she did. King Ahab was looking out the palace window one day. He sees a lovely little vineyard out there. And he said, boy, that would be a nice garden for myself. So he investigates. He finds out whose vineyard it is. They tell him it belongs to a guy named Naboth. He investigates. He goes to Naboth. And he says, Naboth, sell me the vineyard. Naboth says, no, I can't do it. It's part of my inheritance. And King Ahab says, come on, sell it to me. Name your price. Money is no object. He says, I can't do it. This sends King Ahab into a depressive funk. He goes home. He goes to the palace. He lies down. You know clinical depression when you see it, right? He's lying down. He doesn't have the energy to get up. He stops eating. Jezebel comes in and says, what's wrong with you? I wanted to buy the Naboth's vineyard and he won't sell it to me. She said, what don't you understand about the word king? You're in charge, you sniveling little man. Let me show you how it's done. So she calls for the royal stationer and she says, please take this letter. She says, she writes a letter to the elders of Naboth's village and basically says, I don't care how you do it, but I want him dead. The elders of the village get it and they're like, well, because she had signed the king's name to it. They're like, well, the king says we gotta do it, we gotta do it. So they set up this scheme to falsely accuse Naboth. They take him outside of the gates, they take stones in their hands, and they throw the stones, crushing his skull. They kill Naboth. They send the word back that the dirty deed is done. She goes into Ahab and she says, there. That's how a king handles it. Now go take that little vineyard. It's yours. That's how a king gets it done. So that's the kind of woman she was. And you're thinking, what has happened? I mean, remember, this is God's people, right? I mean, these are the people who tell themselves, we are the chosen one. And they are worshiping a calf and the devil. Somebody telling truth to him in the middle of the mess. A man named Elijah comes knocking on the door. Hey, is Ahab in? Yeah, so he goes in and he sees Ahab. It says, this is just to get your attention. It's not going to rain until I say so. See ya. Goes away. So it doesn't rain for a week or two. Probably coincidence. Doesn't rain for a month. Well, you know, these things happen. Doesn't rain for 6 months. That's strange. Doesn't rain for a year. Yikes. Now the crops are failing. It doesn't rain for 2 years. It doesn't rain for 3 years. People are hungry. Elijah comes back. Now that I have your attention, he says to Ahab, I want you to call together all the people of Israel. And then it will rain. Ahab says, okay, whatever you say, we gotta have rain. So Ahab sends out the messengers. Everybody comes together. They meet on a place called Mount Carmel. Now, not Mount Carmel. Right, but Mount Carmel, right there on the edge of the Mediterranean Sea, what today is northern Israel, still right there, mountains still right there. He calls together all the people. Elijah's there. He calls out to everybody and he says, people, listen up. How long are you going to vacillate between these two gods? It's time to choose. It you is or it you ain't. Is God is the real one, true God, the greater God? Is he the one you're going to serve? Or are you going to serve the calf and the Baal? Nobody said anything. He said, okay, here's the way we're going to do it. We're going to have a contest to prove which God is the real God. We're going to have a barbecue cook-off. And everybody's like, yeah, that sounds great. Good idea, Elijah. So he says, here's how we're going to do it. We've got here Baal's prophets. Since these are like the priests of Baal, right? There are 450 of them. But because Jezebel has been killing off the prophets of the true God, Elijah says, and here I am. So it's 450-1. They're going to get a bull, and I'm going to get a bull. They're going to get wood, and I'm going to get wood. But neither one of us is going to get matches. We're both going to pray to our gods. And the God who sends fire from the sky, that's the true God. Okay, this is going to be great. You know, they put the lawn chairs out and everything. So Elijah says, there are 450 of you. You go first. So they get together and they kill their bull and they put the wood down and put the meat on top of it. And then they're like, oh man, does anybody know like a rain dance? I mean, a fire dance? And they're like, no, I don't think so. Well, make something up. So they start dancing around, you know, and they're trying to, you know, a little dust in the air and trying to impress everybody. Then there is no fire from the sky. About noon, they start to get tired. And Elijah is not one to suffer fools, so he starts egging them on. He's like, hey, I bet it's Baal's day off. Tough break for you guys. And this just makes them madder and infuriates them. Oh, I know what he said. I bet he's on vacation. So they start cutting themselves. This was part of the way they impressed people. So they're cutting themselves. Blood's on the ground. I mean, 450 men dancing around. This is a pile of dust. This is a sweaty mass of humanity. They're all dancing, but there is no fire from the sky. Finally, late in the afternoon, they give up. They throw in the towel. And they say, okay, how about you, wise guy? Let's see you get fire from the sky. They made theirs up. They assumed everybody was making it up. Elijah says, okay. He looks around. He finds a big stone. He brings it back and he says, boom. Reuben goes and finds another stone, brings it back. Boom. Simeon goes and finds another stone, brings it back. Boom. Levi finds a fourth stone, brings it back. Judah, he finds 12 stones. Each one for one of the 12 sons of Jacob. Remember, there were 12 sons and one daughter. The whole country should be one, is what he's saying. He builds this like altar out of these stones. Then he got a shovel. And he digs a trench around the perimeter there of the stones. Then he kills his bull and he puts the meat on the, he puts the wood on the stones, and then he puts the meat on the wood. Now you probably know, but you kill a bull and you've got a lot of meat. There's, you know, it's a pretty substantial pile, right? So you got a hindquarter, you've got the roast, you've got the kidneys, you've got the, you know, all the parts are all right there. Then he says, see those four jugs of water? Bring them here. So they bring him four jugs of water, and he pours them on top of this pile. There is going to be no way to escape the conclusion that when fire comes, it came from the sky, not some kind of spontaneous combustion deal. Fill them up, he says. Bring them again. So they bring them again. Four more barrels, pours them on. What are we at? 8. Fill them up, he says. Bring them back. They bring them back. He pours them on. Now we're at 12. 12 again. And he says, come near. People move in. Nearer still. He says, oh God, God of Abraham, of Isaac and Jacob, hear me today. Let these people people know that you're real and I'm not making this stuff up. And that you are turning their hearts back to you. That you are turning their hearts back to you. A column of fire comes from the sky. Fire so hot it consumes the meat. The wood is turned into little fluttering ash bits. Not only is the meat consumed and the wood turned into ash, but the rocks are gone. That's how hot this column of fire. Imagine kind of a bolt of lightning, I think, right? The rocks are gone. The little trench that had filled up with the water that he had poured on it, the water's all been lapped up by the fire. The earth is scorched. The people who have seen this fall on their faces. And it's one person, they chant out, "The Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God." Then they all look at the 450 prophets of Baal. And he says, yeah, they were leading you to death. Now they must die. They take him down in the valley. They kill them. Elijah says, now let's see what we can do about that rain. He says to King Ahab, they didn't kill King Ahab. He says to King Ahab, it's a pity you brought the convertible chariot because you're going to get wet. It really looks like rain. They both look at the sky and there's not a cloud in the sky. So he says, go ahead, eat, drink, you know, have a picnic. I'll be back in a little bit. So Elijah takes his servant to go on higher up the mountain. They get up to where he can look out over the Mediterranean Sea. And he kneels down. He puts his head in the dirt, Elijah does, and he says to his servant, he says, go look and see if there's a cloud. The servant comes back and says, no, there's no cloud. Elijah prays again. He puts his head down and he prays again the second. Now go look. Servant goes and looks. Come back. No, there's no God. Elijah prays a third time. Now go look. No, boss, there is no cloud. Prays a fourth time. Now go look. Goes and looks. No, I'm telling you, there are no clouds out there. He prays a fifth time. Now go look. No, boss. Prays a sixth time. Go look. No, boss. Prays a seventh time. Go look. That's funny. Comes back to Elijah. I don't know if it's one little cloud, it's about the size of the palm of a person's hand. Elijah stands up and he says, that's big enough. Elijah dressed strangely. I mean, he wore a camel's cloak. He ate weird food, too. He takes the, you know, in those days they wouldn't have worn trousers. He had like a robe. So he takes the hem of the robe, he tucks it up his belt. And the Spirit of God comes on him, and he starts running. He runs so fast that even though Ahab is in the chariot trying to get back to the palace, Elijah passes him, running faster than the horses, and as they're heading toward the palace, behind them, that little storm has become a thunderhead, you know, 40,000 feet of clouds and rain, and now the raindrops start falling. It pours. It rains like crazy. So he's seen fire from the sky. He's seen water rain from the sky. He gets there. He's like, and here comes King Ahab. And Elijah says, okay, we settled it, right? Once and for all, right? The decision's been made. No turning back, right? King Ahab goes inside the palace. And you know who is waiting there. Arms crossed, toes tapping. And where have you been, young man? Ahab's like, you know, funny thing happened today. You're not going to believe this. You remember those 450 prophets you had? Craziest thing. She's like, what do you mean I had? So he tells her that they're all dead. She gets a letter. She gets the stationery out again, and she writes a note this time to Elijah. My dear Elijah, today there are 450 dead prophets. Tomorrow by this time there will be 451. If you get my meaning. XO, 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 Jezebel. Well, this terrifies Elijah. I mean, it's crazy enough, right? But it terrifies him. He takes off, he hides. I don't kind of have time to tell you the whole story. But fast forward with me 6 years. Stories are long stories, aren't they? Well told, they're long stories. Every story, in fact, is a long story. 6 years later, Israel is in a war with Syria. Can you imagine it? It's like it's in the news, right, today. Syria and Israel are at war, and King Ahab decides to go out to the battle. He's the king. He's going out to the battle, but he dresses like a normal charioteer. He goes out. He's got a chariot driver. He's out there. He's watching the battle. One of the Syrian archers knocks an arrow in his bow, and without even aiming, just like, whing, lets it fly, goes up in the air. You know, one of these crazy coincidences of life. It comes down right towards Ahab's chariot. And in one of those crazy coincidences of life, it heads right toward Ahab. In one of those crazy coincidences of life, that arrow hits the one spot in his body armor, which would have been made out of leather, but with these seams, it hits that one seam, which left him vulnerable and unprotected, and the arrow plunges deep into his chest. Blood starts spurting on the floor of the chariot. "I'm hit," he says. The chariot driver spins the chariot around, takes him to the rear of the battle, and as the battle wanes that afternoon, Ahab's lifeblood pours out on the chariot floor. He slumps lower and lower in the chariot, and he dies. The chariot driver takes him back to the palace. They bury him. One of his sons becomes king. Another son becomes king, because that first one didn't last very long. A second son becomes king. Elijah goes. Elijah names another king, one who will understand who the one true God is. That guy's name is Jehu. Jehu comes after the son. Jezebel, the sons of Ahab. He finds this king, the son. He shoots him in the back with an arrow. Then he says, "Throw the body over there in that vineyard." And they threw Ahab's and Jezebel's son in that vineyard. Yeah. That vineyard. The one she had gotten at the cost of Naboth's life. Long stories. And now Jehu's coming after Jezebel. She knows he's coming. Interestingly, she chooses to put on her makeup. Now she's an older woman at this point. But she paints her eyes. She brushes her hair. She opens the window. Probably on the second story. She leans out the window, and here comes Jehu with his men. They get to the palace gates, and she calls, "Do you come in peace?" Oh, yeah. He doesn't even respond to her. He just calls up there to the palace, and he says, "Is anybody in there with me?" There's some movement inside the palace. A couple of the servants grab Jezebel's legs and toss her out the window. Splat, she hits the ground below. Now, you know, if you fall from two stories, it's not going to kill you. You know, you might break something, but it's not going to kill you. So they throw the gates open, and Jehu rides in on his horse and tramples her to death. The legs of the horse are bathed in the blood of that evil woman. He goes in with his men and they have dinner. After dinner, he's feeling a little more relaxed and he says, "You know what? After all said and done, she was a princess. Go out and bury her. You, go bury her." So this little detail goes out with the shovels to bury her, but they come back quickly. He says, "I thought I told you to bury her." "Sorry, boss. Couldn't do it. The dogs got to her." funny, now that I think about it, you know, Elijah didn't get buried either. Elijah is walking along the road with his sidekick, a man named Elisha. Elijah and Elisha are walking along the road. And it's like a wormhole opens up. I mean, an anomaly in the space-time continuum. And out of the sky comes, they were only able to describe it like this, comes chariot and horses on fire. I mean, they had no other vocabulary. I mean, maybe that was it, but this is the only vocabulary they had to describe. A chariot and horses on fire came down out of the sky. And there's this movement of wind like a tornado. The chariot comes right toward Elijah. As it comes down, he just steps on that chariot and it takes him away and he never dies, he's never buried.
Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home.
You know that's where that song comes from, don't you? That's that story.